had to figure out how to advance the slide there for a second. Actually, this is an extension of a presentation I did at the Spruce Woods Star Party, which was had some open astronomy content as well as amateur telescope making, and the two are quite intertwined, as you'll probably see in this presentation. But this is mostly talking about tools that are available from the open source world or the open hardware world that are used in astronomy. And I'm basing my whole software environment on open source software. And I have a video that's a demonstration of that. Obviously, we can't do a live demonstration of that, given that, one, it's not dark, and two, it's cloudy out. But I have recorded some stuff, not as much as I'd hoped. So there are some facets of the operation that I can't show you tonight. But I'm actually doing some webcasting of the observatory console as well. So if you join that channel, you might be able to see all the different parts of the thing in operation. So, what is open astronomy? So I look at it from five different viewpoints. First of all, there's open standards, and those have been around a while. ASCOM, which is the Windows-based standard, it's debatable how open it is, but the ASCOM standard for devices interoperating with each other has been around a while. A more recent vintage is INDI, which is a open source Linux, Macintosh, lots of different devices type standard that basically allows you to plug in virtually any device and have it operate with the software you're using or the different parts of the system. So INDI is very important for my setup because all of the pieces are all using INDI drivers. INDI means is initials INDI stand for independent device something. So also important in open astronomy is open source software, because there's a lot of software that's out there that has been published for astronomy. A lot of it has been published by scientific organizations, and a lot has been published by just individuals that decide to scratch an itch. They want a new guiding software, or they want a new camera driver or whatever, and they release it all as open source. And that means that the source code is available to everybody, and other people can get involved in modifying it and enhancing it. And that's what's happened on a lot of the software. So you've got software that's open source that's starting to rival commercial software in capability, and in some cases surpass commercial software, because you have a lot more people working on it, a lot more people inputting things, and it can leverage other stuff that's already done. For example, the internal guiding software in the software I use is actually derived from another project called LinGuider. It's been baked into the software I use so that you can do guiding with the software and so on. Another sort of pillar for the open astronomy is open hardware. So you've got a lot of hardware devices that have been developed by communities that are very widely available and very, very inexpensive to use. So open hardware is means that you can start deploying into the Internet of Things, and you can start deploying devices all over the place and using open source software to run them. Another pillar is open manufacturing. We now have things like 3D printers that allow us to just, if you need something, you can go find it on the internet and print it. So we'll talk about that. And finally, open communities. All of these things are driven by the fact there's open communities where people can support each other, distribute their information, and share amongst themselves. So that's pretty important as well. So looking at some of the open astronomy tools, I guess, you know, astronomy software, well, obviously there's always been a lot of open source and public domain and shareware, as well as commercial astronomy software. So I'm not going to go into too much detail on this. I do want to point out, I do have a page on my website which has a fairly exhaustive list of primarily open source software and open source and community supported software. So if you're interested in looking at the software I'm talking about tonight, it's all listed on my website. So and anything I've been able to actually use and review, I've been able to put some recommendations in there as well. So if you're interested in the software side of things, feel free to hop on my site and have a look and then enjoy. So we'll take a good look at some software in a bit. On the hardware side, this is really interesting, where you can now deploy, it used to be you'd have to get a laptop and you'd have to take it out to the observatory and use it while you were using your telescope. And then probably it's, either it's your only laptop and you'd have to unhook everything and take it in again, or it's an old, crappy old laptop that may have some limited capabilities. These days, you can buy a Raspberry Pi, which is a full-up microcomputer on a board, very capable and runs the Linux operating system. And I've got one of these things, attached to the pier of my telescope, and it just sits there all day long. I can connect to it anytime I want, and it runs the entire observatory. So Raspberry Pis are a bit of a breakthrough in very, very inexpensive computing that you can put, if you have five different purposes in one place for Raspberry Pis, they're cheap enough you can put five Raspberry Pis in. So they're under $100 full up for the computer, and you'll see it operating. A telescope I'm building right now will actually have a couple of Raspberry Pis sitting on it just doing different things. Arduino is another one. Arduino is a company, I think, in Italy that's created a very simple to use single board computer. It, unlike the Raspberry Pi, it's not really a computer that's replacing a Windows desktop. Where Arduino's really shine is in doing real-time device type stuff. So for example, it's really good at running telescope motors and pulsing them on a deterministic basis, so that that your telescope is actually tracking and it's not off serving some other purpose, like seeing where your mouse is and drawing windows and stuff. So the combination of Raspberry Pis and Arduinos are very powerful for basing telescope systems on, as well as other things. And other boards, the MKS Gen L board, there is actually a printer, 3D printer controller card. It costs about $17, and it allows you to hook up to five stepper motor drivers, those little purple things in the bottom, and control five motors. So you'd have an RA and a deck and a focuser motor and a rotator and all those kind of things. And the nice thing is there's lots of software out there to drive these things as well. So, and open manufacturing, obviously, 3D printing has really added a dimension to, doing astronomy stuff that is kind of new, where if you need something, you can just go print it. And people are creating some pretty amazing projects. Now, on the left-hand side there, you'll see I was automating a mount, and I needed some motor brackets. So I went on the internet, found the motor brackets. At the time, I didn't have a printer, so I paid a guy to print them for me, and he shipped them to me, and I used them. So now that I have a 3D printer, I gave it to my son for Christmas, right? That's always the great dad thing to do. Now I can print things like over on the top right, you see that red box. I've printed one of those. That's a case for the controller on my computer or on my telescope. And you see the thing in the bottom right-hand corner. That's actually a very intriguing project. That's a spectrograph, a higher medium resolution spectrograph. You can print all the parts on your 3D printer and then buy a bunch of optics, and you'll have a fairly sophisticated spectrograph for under $1,000. Whereas if you go out and buy one, you're talking $3,000 or $4,000 minimum for an Alpi or something fairly low resolution. So that's very intriguing. The kind of things that people are doing with 3D printers is very interesting. I follow a Facebook site called 3D Printing for Astronomy, and virtually every day somebody posts a picture of something very interesting, whether it be you know, mounting rings for finder scopes or adapters of some kind, or even that filter wheel that you see in the middle top there. It's always lots of neat stuff that people are doing with 3D printers. So open manufacturing has become a thing as well. And of course, they're sharing the 3D models for all of this stuff so you can print it for yourself. So it's very interesting. And of course, sharing needs community. And there's a lot of communities out there that are now available so people can share what they're doing and get assistance and basically work with people who are like-minded. On open source software, obviously, you've got people contributing actual code and expertise on these software projects as well. So there's a lot of really good communities. Cloudy Nights is probably the one I'm on most. That's cloudynights.com is an astronomy website that's has a lot of different focuses, but a lot of people who do amateur telescope making congregate on that site. Groups.io is actually taking over for Yahoo Groups. Yahoo Groups used to be a big one as well, but it started to shut things down, so it's all moved over to groups.io. So if you're looking for astronomy stuff, those are two really good sites, and you can find information. Obviously, Facebook, there's a lot of different communities on Facebook. Amateur Telescope Making is one I belong to, that have a lot of expertise. If you want to ask a question, you get quick answers. And then on the, as far as the 3D manufacturing side of things, I find STL Finder and MakerBot Thingiverse are really neat search engines for 3D design. So if I want to get a spectrograph, for example, design, I can go on there and you're actually going to find it. So it's pretty interesting. So that's kind of the pillars of the open astronomy. And then putting these things together becomes kind of Lego blocks. So some of these example applications, this looks a little complicated, but it's actually about as complicated as, you know, those, if anybody was a geek like I was when I was a kid and your parents bought you a Radio Shack electronics experimenter kit, 52-in-1, or you had little springs that you'd put the wires in. Well, this is about as complicated as that. So OnStep is the software that drives the circuit, and it runs on Arduinos. And in this case, this little circuit over on the right-hand side here is essentially on the left, you see a little chip that's basically an Arduino controller. You've got a couple of motor controllers, a Bluetooth transceiver, and just a bunch of stuff to tie it all together. And that will drive two motors that you attach to your telescope. And this will actually basically emulate a Meade LX200 telescope through Bluetooth, right? And the cost is very minimal. Like the Bluetooth module is actually the most expensive thing. So you're spending $30 for an Arduino. You're spending $15 for some driver chips, $10 each for some stepper motors, and the Bluetooth module is $40. So basically for $100, $120, you've got a full-up telescope drive system that can replace what you may have on a telescope or be added to a telescope that doesn't have a drive system. And it is extremely powerful software. It has a lot of stuff like periodic error correction, mount modeling, all of that kind of stuff is all kind of built into it. So it's pretty powerful stuff. So if you're interested in that, you'll see down at the bottom is a link to the groups.io link for OnStep. So if you're interested in any sort of mount automation, that's definitely a useful thing. So one application of that is I had an old CG5 mount where the motor system had died, so I added OnStep to it. You'll see that I've got 3D printed motor brackets. I've got GT2 gears, which are just timing gears you can get off eBay for a couple of bucks. It's being run by a Raspberry Pi, and it's quite functional, right? So the total cost of this was probably under $50, and you can replace the motor system on a telescope. And it's not all that hard to do. Using the MKS Gen L board means you don't have to solder anything. So that makes it easy. because I can't solder to save my life. So another application which is interesting is for Arduinos is there's lots of designs out there for weather stations. So you get an Arduino and then you hook up some sensors to it, which are readily available, and you can set up a full weather station. And again, it's got an Indie driver for it. So people have built the software already. So you don't have to do any software stuff. You just have to put together the Lego blocks of the hardware and run the software and you're good to go. So that's, you know, there's a lot of designs for weather stations and that sort of thing, which use this technology. This is something that I'm working on right now. I'm just waiting on my acrylic dome to come from a slow boat from China. But this is an all-sky camera, as you can see on the left-hand side. I wish I had a pointer, but it doesn't look like I'm able to point here. So you'll see the you see there's a ZWO AWI or sorry, ZWO ASI 224 or something camera underneath the acrylic dome there. It has a wide angle lens on it. And inside the box is a Raspberry Pi. And that runs the camera and you hook it up to your network and it will allow you to get full, very nice full sky views, meteors, that sort of thing. Again, the Pi is running open source software that's readily available, and you just link to it as a website. And in my case, I'm going to put it up a pole so it's above my roof line, and I'm running a power over Ethernet hat on the RPI, which again is an open hardware piece that allows you to run power over an Ethernet cable. And then the Ethernet cable will go into the observatory, and I'll be able to have full sky views on that. So, yeah.
Question for you. On this all-sky camera that you're designing here, will you be able to do basically the equivalent of NELM measurements as well or sky darkness using software?
I don't think that's a function of the software. You know, conceivably you could, sure.
But, yeah, you know what I'm thinking of, hey, is like an integrated photometric evaluation based on the field of view of the camera. It could give you a pretty good indication of the NELM values there at night.
Yeah, I think there's probably better tools for that. But at the same time, the sky's the limit, right? Most people use these cameras for meteorite observations, for full sky, you know, obviously weather conditions in observatories, which is my primary use, as well as doing you know, sort of 360 sky rotations, star trail type photography. So, but yeah, you just have to write the software, which is the hard part. Usually the hardware is fairly easy to put together, but if somebody has written the software to do that, then you can use it. So it'd be an interesting thing to look into if you're interested, because there's a lot of people doing this, all sky camera stuff. If you go on Facebook and, search for All Sky. There's a very active group on Facebook on these All Sky cameras, but a lot of people are putting them together. It's pretty easy to do. And the other sort of open manufacturing integration there is the brackets I'm using for my camera are printed off a 3D printer, which just made it easy. So, and this is an interesting one as well. Plate solving, we'll talk about a little later, but this is a fellow that's put his a really cheap camera on his telescope and hooked it to a Raspberry Pi. And now he's written a script that just basically sits and does plate solves all the time on his Dobsonian telescope. But if it does a plate solve, it's basically telling you exactly where it is in the sky. So it's almost like closed loop digital setting circles. So he can point his telescope at the sky, wait a minute, and it'll tell him exactly where it's pointed at. And using Sky Safari, obviously, he can use that data to actually direct him to where he wants to point the telescope. This isn't a a driven telescope, so it's a push-to sort of scenario. But it means that you, instead of needing encoders and doing alignments and all that sort of stuff, it's all built into the script that he's using. And again, a little, you know, Raspberry Pi on the scope hooked up to the camera, and you can use Sky Safari on, you know, your phone or a laptop and communicate with it. So it's a kind of neat application. And I'm actually looking at putting something like that on the telescope I'm working on as well. So this is an early picture. I actually am much further ahead than I was when I took this picture, but this is my 16-inch telescope that's currently being built. And I'm putting a lot of toys on it, basically. I'm calling it the new technology telescope because it's going to have a whole bunch of toys that we've talked about today. It's, you know, the internals are a 16-inch f4.5 Meade Starfinder optics. But it's going to have hexapod collimation, which means collimation can be done but just by rotating the truss members instead of needing to turn knobs on the back of the mirror cell. It will be running within our Raspberry Pi 4, which will be driving the motors and running the plate solving. And it'll also probably have a Raspberry Pi up in the secondary cage, which will be doing some controlling of sky tours and some voice recognition stuff. You know, just pack as many toys as possible into it. Remote control will be via an indie server, probably on an iPad or some other device with indie and Sky Safari. It'll have a GPS dongle, so it always knows where it is and when. And it'll have that continuous plate solving tool so that it'll always know what it's pointing at. So instead of having to do like NSTAR alignments and do a lot of messing around to figure out what it's pointing at, it will figure it out by itself and close that loop. And we'll look at some plate solving stuff in a sec. The other thing I mentioned earlier is I've been playing around with YouTube and doing webcasting. There's some cool software called Open Broadcast Software, which is free, open source stuff, and you can actually use that to do webcasts to YouTube. And I've been actually webcasting the observatory operating screen. So if you're interested in seeing that, you can join the channel. Join my channel. It'll send you an email when that's active. Most of the video I'm going to be showing right now was recorded through that. Basically, I uploaded it as a live webcast to YouTube and then downloaded the video and edited it. But that's pretty cool. If folks want to do live webcasts of what they're doing on their telescope, or Brian, if you wanted to webcast your Mallencam stuff, super easy to do, and it's all free. So, you know, we're in Winnipeg, but you gotta make sure you're not spending any money. So this is what we're going to be looking at in more detail. This is my Celestron 8-inch in the observatory. It's on a Sirius mount with a Canon DSLR on it. It's got an off-axis guider and a star chute, which I am still fighting with to get working properly. I also use a planetary camera on it. It's got automated focusing, but the whole show is being run by a Raspberry Pi 4 running StellarMate software, which is a version of Linux that's been pre-configured for astronomy. So without further ado, I'm going to show you a video. It's obviously, it was easier to take some video and roll it all up into a video to show you than try to get a dark night with no clouds. So the beginning is just a bit of a tour of the K-STARS ECOS software, which is all open source observatory and imaging software. And it's all running on a Raspberry Pi. I basically sit at my kitchen table and run it remotely as well, so you'll see that. So any questions? I can't see the chat here, unfortunately. Let's see if I can find it. Yeah, I'm not finding it. I'll exit full screen, that might help.
Yeah, I think Sean has a question here. Here, I'm going to do this.
Yeah, I can't see, you know, when you're actually sharing your screen, it changes your interface here, so I can't see.
Yeah, it does. Okay, so Sean, I'm going to allow him to talk because he has a question, I believe. Sean, are you there?
I'm here.
All right, so you have a question?
Yeah, it was just I was interested to know just about how you were controlling the powering up and powering down of your Raspberry Pi. I know some of the earlier versions really didn't like having their plugs pulled without sort of doing a proper shutdown. So I'm not sure if the newer versions are maybe a little bit more amenable to that, or if you still have to worry about how they're getting powered up and down.
All Unixes used to have a problem with that, but you know, I don't bother shutting it off, shutting it down gracefully. I just pull the plug. I push the button. It's really been almost like just any electronic device. It's not really like a computer. You just turn it on when you want it to run, and you turn it off when you're done with it. So I basically have a power bar at the base of my pier that I just, when I want to shut it down, which is actually fairly seldom, I just hit the power bar at the base of the pier and it shuts everything down on the pier. So, and you'll probably see a lot more detail when I run the video. So if there's no further questions. Okay, so what we're going to do is have a look at the console for the Snowy Plains Astrophysical Observatory. This is a observatory that I run in my backyard. It's a 10x10 shed with a roll-off roof, and it's got a Celestron telescope inside with a bunch of trimmings. So we're going to have a look at the control console and operate the telescope and show you all the different things it can do. So, first thing I need to do is I'm in NoVNC. This is basically just connecting to the Raspberry Pi computer in the observatory through a certain port, and it comes up with NoVNC, and I can put that full screen so it's a little easier to see, and I'll connect to it, and it connects through a gigabit network out to the shed, and now I can see the main display on the Raspberry Pi. And what's running right now is an application called KSTARS. KSTARS has a couple of major components to it, one of which is this planetarium software. There's another component called ECOS, which is the imaging and telescope control system. So it's all based on the INDI protocol for Linux. The Raspberry Pi runs a version of the Linux operating system called Raspbian, and it's been configured by a company called StellarMate. It's kind of an organization versus a company, but StellarMate customizes Raspbian for astronomical use, pre
configures things like Indy and K-Stars and ECOS and various other applications, and then puts it out as a product. So it's about $49 US to buy StellarMate, and it is absolutely worthwhile because everything comes pre-configured and auto-updated, all integrated, pre-compiled, all that kind of stuff. So especially if you're a beginner, StellarMate is really good, even if you have your own Raspberry Pi, or you can buy a version of StellarMate with its own Raspberry Pi for about $149 or something like that. So as you can see, it thinks we're in Winnipeg, which is good. We're actually recording this at 2:00 in the afternoon, so that's why the sun is up and Mercury's up. So we're not going to move the telescope around. As a matter of fact, telescope's parked right now. Observatory is mostly closed, but we're going to show you the various parts of the system, and then we'll move on once it gets dark and we get a dark night. We'll move on to looking at taking some pictures and using some of the different functions. So one of the first things that we want to do is we want to turn on ECOS and get Indy up and running. So as a matter of fact, it appears that I left it running last time, so I'm going to stop it, disconnect all the devices and stop it. And this is what you see when you first start up ECOS. It's basically, you set up a profile with various devices in it, and in this case it's saying this is the SPAO DSLR configuration. I'm using Pushhear Dummy 2 for guiding. I'm using an EQ mod mount, which is a basically a cable that replaces the hand pad on a HEQ5 mount. So mine happens to be a Orion Sirius EQG mount. It's running with an EQ mod cable, that's why we select that. Using a Canon DSLR, an Orion Starshoot, which is a repackaged QHY CCD, that's my guide camera. And then I'm using a device called a Shoestring FC USB, which is a focus motor controller, and that's controlling a motofocus on my telescope, so I can do automated focusing. You know, we can set up other things here. I don't have a filter wheel, I don't have adaptive optics, the dome isn't controlled, I don't have a weather station, but I do have a joystick, and I use the joystick for actually controlling the telescope when I'm sitting out in the observatory. So I'm going to hit save on that because that's what I want, and just going to hit the play button, which starts it all up. And this pops up. This is the Indy control panel, and it shows you all of the drivers for up and running, connected, and it gives you the ability to make changes to your configuration. So if we look at the EQ mod mount, it shows us how it's currently configured, but we can also do things with it right from here. If I did want to move the telescope to a certain RAN deck, I could type in coordinates, hit set, and the telescope would move there. Now that's fairly inconvenient, so we don't do it that way, but some stuff is convenient. For example, if I wanted to change the park position of the telescope, I can go to site management, move the telescope to where I want to park it, and then click current, and it'll park at those locations forevermore. And this is also where we set up what buttons do what on the joystick, that kind of thing. But generally, once this is started up, we don't need to do much with it, so we can close that. And now we're in the control panel. Now, once again, you don't do too much with this. It does show you some status information, and while we're focusing and guiding, it shows you that. But these tabs along the top are the things that you spend most of your time in. We're going to skip this one for now, but we're going to go into the camera setup. And one of the things I wanted to do today is actually take some bias frames and some darks. So I'm going to put some settings in. And what you do is you put your settings in as you like them, and then you hit plus, and it puts it into a sequence queue. So you can queue up a whole bunch of stuff in the sequence queue and have it all run unattended. So for example, if I wanted to, first of all, I want to take some bias frames. So I'm going to set the exposure to as low as it goes. and I'm going to say this is bias frames. What this will do is it'll actually save the file in a folder called bias under the directory of specify, which is home stellar-made pictures. And I'm going to put a prefix in here. No, I'm not going to bother putting a prefix in. I'll show you that later. And that's it. So my exposure is as small as it gets. I'm going to take 25 of them so I can stack them. I'm going to set the ISO at 800 because that's generally what I shoot at. That's I'm going to be not as noisy as some of the higher ISOs, but the camera will not be quite as sensitive, or it won't be quite as amplified. So the more amplification you get, the more noise you get. So I'm going to leave that at 800, and then I'm just going to say, okay, we're going to take 25 of those. Now I also have the telescope set up for darks. Obviously it's covered up, so we can do some darks. So I'm going to start out and do some 60 second exposures, quantity 25, ISO 800, and I'm actually going to put a free prefix in here, dark 60, so I know what the exposure is, and 800, which is the ISO. All right, so this is kind of my own convention, so I know what's what. Okay, so once again, we can say 60, 25, set all that up, hit plus, and we're good to go. Now I can also increase that to 120 seconds and take some darks at 120 seconds, and I can take some darks at 180, and 300 seconds is the most I can get on a guided exposure. So these are my darks. The temperature outside is cool, so it's roughly approximately what I'll be shooting at, so this pretty well approximates for darks what I'll need to use in nighttime shots. So that being done, I could hit plus on this and then it would go away and start taking pictures. Actually I will, because you can keep doing things. It says cover up the telescope, okay, and then off it goes. So you see the progress bar here. We're capturing an image, that's the image, and then we're going to do that 25 times. So it takes longer to actually download the image than it does to capture the image, obviously. So I'm going to hide that viewer, or else it'll pop up every time to show me the picture, and you can see it's already 3 of 25 complete. So it'll do this operation, and then it'll go into that operation, and so on. So it's going to be busy for a few hours. So, but of course, it's not dark out and it's cloudy, so this is a good time to do it. As long as the temperature is the same as when you're imaging, you're in good shape. So going through some of these other options, first of all, I do have a focuser. I have that Shoestring Astronomy FC USB, which is basically a motor controller. It connects to the Motofocus motor and moves it back and forth. So you can move it back and forth manually, or you can autofocus, and we'll take a look at that later. Moving to the next tab, this is my mount tab, and it shows me that I'm parked, and I can unpark it from here and turn tracking on. This is where I can set up the aperture and focal length of my scope, which is used for various reasons, and other configuration, and see what's happening with the telescope. We can also do things like clear the internal model. The model is something that the software keeps track of what's happening with the telescope. If it needs to do some changes when it's slewing, you can retain that information, and slewing gets more and more and more accurate as you go. But if something goes wrong and can corrupt the data a little bit, you can clear that model and start again. The next tab is our solver tab, and this is a very handy feature where if we go into a slew, we can go to this tab and then say capture and solve, and it will take a picture with the, in this case it's a 10 second exposure through the main camera, and it will do a solve on astrometry.net We can also do a local solve, and I tend to bounce back and forth between these two. You can do an offline solve, and it'll be done on the Raspberry Pi, which can be a little slower than an online solve, which is connecting to astrometry.net and doing the solve remotely. You can also use a Windows-based ASTAP-based solver, which some people use, but I use astrometry.net. And there's a whole bunch of options around that too, which we won't go into. So capture and solve will basically take a picture, do a solve, show you what the RA and DEC is, and if I do a SLU to target, it will actually say, oh, okay, I'm not at the correct RA and DEC, and it does a SLU to the correct RA and DEC and then starts repeating that process until it reaches a certain level of accuracy, which in this case is 30 arc seconds. So what happens in real life is basically it SLUs, it's not quite accurate, it does a solve, it SLUs to where it thinks it is, it's not quite accurate, it does another SLU and continues until either you stop it or it's within the threshold that you set. Excuse me. And then finally we have guiding, and again this guiding is not being used. This is the internal guiding, which is based on LinGuider. I actually use Push Here Dummy, and we'll see that in operation soon enough. So we go back to our camera and see how we're doing, and this task has been completed, and we have other tasks that are still working. Now what we can do is we can actually save this sequence when it's not running, and then we can load it into this next tab here, which is actually allows you to queue up different targets with different sequences. So for example, if I had a variable star I take pictures of, and I generally take red, green, blue, or different filters for that star, I can set all that up in my camera with all the different exposures that I want to take, and then I can add that target to the object and sequence selection, and then queue up a whole bunch of targets and run that as a job, and it can do the tracking, focus, aligning, and guiding all automatically. So it would SLU to the object, it would do a solve and solve till it knew it was in the field of view, and then it would do the guiding, focus, it would focus, it would guide, and so on. So very, very powerful, and that's a whole separate video in and of itself. So that's kind of what you have, and the next thing to do is wait for it to get dark and go out and take some pictures with all of these flats and darks and everything else I've taken. Oh, I did mention flats. I won't show it here. You can change the type to flat, and you can actually see flats being created as well. If we go into the file system here under pictures, you can see I've got darks, flat, bias, so on, and it stores the data in FITS files underneath. So my lights will show up in here as well. One other thing that I do with this that you'll see is somewhere in here, I'm using a program called AstroDMX Capture, which is actually a planetary imaging system. People use it to actually capture images of planets. What I use it for is I have a camera, and I'm going to connect to it here. I have a camera in the observatory, which is just a cheap USB camera, and it'll do 640 by 480. If I connect to it, it will actually show me what's going on in the observatory, which in this case is a telescope lit up with a garbage bag over it, as well as its cover to make sure no light gets in. So if I make this smaller again, generally I have this hanging around on my desktop. So if I do want to look at what the telescope's up to, I just connect to AstroDMX, or just leave this kind of hanging around, and then I can see what's up with the telescope. So that's about it. The other thing that I do in the observatory is I have a luminescent panel, and the telescope can point at that, and I can take flats with the luminescent panel and not have to do sky flats or anything, you know, put anything over the telescope. So let's get observing. So what we're going to do here, first of all, is we're going to do some slewing and solving with the telescope. So I have no idea whether this is aligned or not, and it doesn't really matter at this point, but let's slew over to Arcturus and see if the telescope actually goes there. And nope. So you can see from the view of the telescope, it's still slewing. So I'll keep my finger on the stop button here and we'll see where it goes. But it's definitely not slewing towards Arcturus. So let's see where it ends up. So of course, the planetarium software thinks it's arrived at its destination, but we can use the, we'll check the tracking is on, but we can use the capture and solve function to say, okay, well, figure out where you are, and then we'll slew to the target. So first thing it does is takes its 10-second exposure with the main camera, and that will give us a star field. And the way these solvers work is they actually have a very large number of triangles or quadrilaterals stored as hashes, and which is numeric representations of that data, and they've indexed those hashes into a table. And once it figures out what the field of view is, it uses the hash of the stars it can see to compare against the hash of the stars that are in the table, and it can do a solve based on that. So what I'm using here is I'm using the online version of astrometry.net, and what it does is it'll upload that image to astrometry.net, and the solve will actually be done on their servers. Now this takes a while in this sequence because astrometry.net is fairly slow, but if we use a local copy of astrometry.net, it generally takes about 17 seconds. I think right now I have astrometry.net set to do a blind solve as well, which means it takes a fair bit longer. So as you can see, the solve is complete, and it has slewed to it's where it thinks the target should be, which is still not quite correct, so it's going to do another one and upload that file to astrometry.net. You can see the error in red is quite significant, and hopefully it will get more and more accurate as it iterates through this process. Again, this telescope isn't aligned at all. The model is definitely not correct, so that's why this will take a little bit longer the first time through in an evening. So you can see the offline version as well. We can flip over to that, and hopefully it will take a little bit shorter amount of time. So there you go, it's now slewing to target coordinates, and that looks more like it. You can see the Arcturus is actually in that portion of the sky it's slewing towards now, so that should be a much better slew than we've had previously. So once again, once the slew is complete, it says, okay, well, the target accuracy has not been met, so we're going to run the solver again. This time it's the offline solver, so hopefully it'll take about 17 seconds, maybe a bit longer, because I don't think I have the RAN deck that it thinks it's at being passed. Oh no, that was fairly quick. And there it is, there's Arcturus right there, so that was pretty decent. The solve function is really important if you have a mount That's not totally premium if you haven't spent a humongous amount of money on your mount, and it tends to be a little inexact in its slewing for a go-to mount. This is invaluable, especially if you're doing what the kind of stuff that I do, which is variable star photometry, where you're slewing to basically a random star field. It's very difficult to tell whether you're pointed at the right thing or not. If it's an object like a galaxy or something, you can tell. But if it's not, you're slewing to a random star field, and it's very, very helpful to have a solve done right then and there to tell you you're pointing at exactly what you need to. The variable stars in the center of your field, that's important because, you know, things change toward the end of the star field in a photograph, so you have to make sure that your object is centered. The comparison stars are close to it, and you know where it is. So this solving function is very, very helpful. So now that we're at Arcturus, we'll slew over to something a little more interesting and then take some images. One thing I forgot to mention, you'll notice a load and slew button there. That's pretty handy too, because you can actually hit that button, select an existing image, and it will slew to the RAN deck. That is the center of that image. So if you've taken a picture previously and you want to get right back to where you were, you can do a load and slew, and it'll put you right back where you were exactly. So now we're going to, we have slewed over to look in LEO, and we're looking at NGC 3628 in LEO. So we're taking some pictures. This is a little like watching paint dry, because essentially you've set your exposure, you've sent your count, you've put it in the sequence queue, and it will sit in and just take pictures. So you'll see that right now we're capturing a 60-second image of NGC 3628. You can see the little smudge that is the galaxy. And you'll notice that this camera has fairly significant amp glow along the side there. So that's why we take flats, because the flat will take that out of the image. And that way we can get much more pristine images without having to actually crop it a fair bit. So not too much exciting in the taking images department. So it's kind of watching paint dry, but so this is what imaging actually looks like. As each image is taken, they put it into a FITS viewer so that you can see the last image it took and see if there's any changes to be made. So we're taking 60-second subs of this object, and then we can stack those and reduce the noise a bit. Generally I'd take longer exposures, but currently my polar alignment isn't terribly great. For variable stars, you're usually taking a lot shorter exposures, so it's not a big deal, but for these deep sky objects it's obviously a lot more difficult, so I need to get guiding going as well.